First of all, I'd like to thank FPR and everybody involved in this, Rob and Connie and everybody else who made this wonderful conference possible. I think this is a great stepping stone for further development of the field that includes culture, brain, human mind, and genetics. So thank you so much. Well, today I'd like to talk about my own research on culture and cell with some additional data on my own adventure into neuroscience. But I'd like to place this research in somewhat larger historical perspective by very quickly reviewing what happened in the field in the last maybe two decades or three decades, and try to place it in the current research within this framework. So, background. Well, cultural research, research on culture, obviously, can be traced back to many years ago. Some can trace it back to Aristotle, obviously, and many anthropologists in the 19th century, and so on. But current endeavor, which is called cultural psychology, really started out in 1980s or 1990s when Rob's advisor, Rick Schwader, in Chicago, asserted, culture and psyche make each other up. And I think this statement really caused a lot of problems among psychologists. Some psychologists simply ignored it. Rick is a little bit eccentric anyway. It was easy for psychologists to ignore. Some other psychologists took it more seriously. Okay, it does make sense to say that human psyche make up culture. After all, culture cannot exist without some kind of activity of human psychology, psychological systems. But what's the point in saying that culture can make up psyche? Psyche isn't the case. The psychology is very much that of analyzing and processing and producing output out of the basis of the analysis on the basis of input. So basically, psychological system as a processing structure and processing system, if you believe this cognitive psychology assumption, it's very hard to even begin understanding how come that culture can make up the human psyche. So that really was a starting point. And around the time, many students of developmental psychology, social psychology, began taking this statement very seriously to try to find out how it can be that this happens. Okay. Now, question is how to figure it out, and nobody knew. And this was our way of addressing it, and COI already gave a very crisp description of it. This is obviously very, very, very simplistic, but you have to start from somewhere. And once you start out, things can get very muddy and very complicated very, very, very quickly. But here's a conceptual framework. Essentially, there are very different worldview models of the self. The concept of the self may be culturally dependent. And mind may not be purely natural, but the human mind itself might be shaped in some way in accordance with the model of the person that is being shared in a given cultural context. I think that's a kind of a general statement we try to make. And in addition to it, we try to make a point that as a consequence of this, even what psychologists regard as basic psychological processes might be shaped in some significant way as a result of this interaction between human mind and cultural mold, that is, ways in which culture is set up according to the conception of the person which is held, endorsed in a given cultural community. Now, really, this became very, very dominant framework, fortunately, unfortunately, I don't know. We call it one model independent and the other model interdependent, and we claim that the independent model is relatively more dominant in Western cultural context. Now, it's very clear that it's true with respect to North American middle class population, much less true in working class population, and less true even in Western Europe. But here's independent culture in North America. And we contrasted this with interdependent cultural view, which is more dominant in East Asian cultural context. Now it's getting to be clearer, this interdependent model with a variety of different variants are more dominant in many other parts of the world. So that's part of the basis for Steve Hyland and his group's claim that North Americans are really weird. And in the last 20 years or so, there are many, many cross-cultural experiments which are typically followed by cultural priming experiments to investigate what you might regard as a causal mechanism of cultural influence. And this really, as a result of this endeavor, fairly replicable set of phenomena emerge, and now the field tries to grow out of this, and field is trying to develop in several important directions. First of all, it's really important to go far beyond East and the West. There are many other important areas, and also going beyond independence and interdependence, maybe hierarchy, social class, socioeconomic status. Those are the terms which are maybe hopefully filling in the void, and going beyond college and graduate. And by the way, much of this research is based on college and graduates, but recently we conducted study, very large scale study, in part in collaboration with Seattle, but in part collaboration with other people to show that many of the findings I'm going to talk about today are pretty replicable, at least as concerned, as far as Americans and Japanese are concerned. Okay, so it's not really limited to current undergraduate. However, it's very important to explore much larger population. And finally, cultural neuroscience. Here, I'd like to say something about it. All right, so before going to cultural neuroscience, here's a paper which we published 20 years ago. It's amazing. And here, here's a table which we use to summarize our hypothesis, our claim. And back then, strangely, in retrospect, we used the term construal, self-construal. And as a result of this, people regarded this as purely cognitive concept, that is, conception of the self, cognitive psychological conception of the self as independent or interdependent. And that's part of it. But really, what we meant by this was described in this little role, in this table, which we call cultural tasks. We say that the cultural world is organized by this cultural model as independent or interdependent. What that means is that culture gives you, provides you with a whole bunch of conventions, routines, and practices, cultural tasks, which are designed by the previous generations so that you can do those tasks to carry out what the culture regards as independent or interdependent. So for example, in a typical Western cultural context, be unique, expressing the self, realizing internal attributes, actualizing them, pursuing one's own goal, and all those things are cultural tasks which are held in place in this cultural context. They are represented, they are shared in textbooks, socialization practices, and a whole bunch of things. And now, interdependent selves are equally out there in terms of cultural practices. So those are the cultural tasks which are available, and if you are born into that particular cultural context, you pick out, essentially, sometimes intentionally, some other times, almost by necessity, you pick up some tasks which are made available and possible by your particular circumstances to pick up your own task to be a person. And as a consequence, by engaging in those tasks, very much like cab drivers are driving their cabs, your brain may get transformed in the process. That's the context in which I found cultural neuroscience research really fascinating. It's really behavioral engagement in the culture. And as a result of engagement, first of all, behavior might change. So a lot of research has been done to investigate this possibility. So let me skip all those wordy slides to move on specific research. So this is a general concept and very simplified. There are a whole bunch of cultural tests. You are born into a given cultural context. You choose, you pick up, or you adopt some cultural test to become a person, essentially. The person you regard as decent, and also other people in the same community would regard as decent and respectable. And as a consequence of keeping doing and repeatedly engaging in those cultural tasks of your own choice, your brain get transformed. So I'd like to see why I already did a wonderful job in describing the research of self. So now I'd like to focus a bit on emotional regulation. Already He Jun Kim talked about emotion suppression yesterday, and just this slide is meant to illustrate some truth involved in the discussion of He Jun yesterday. This is a picture from tragedy in an earthquake that hit eastern Japan about 15 months ago. And yeah, these are just horrible scenes, but one particular picture I'd like to draw your attention to are the picture of the victims. You know, those victims are very calm, very disciplined, so almost presumably suppressing their emotions. What's going on? You might remember LA Times, New York Times, and so on, really highlighted those, you know, emotionless victims and try to speculate what might happen to those people. You know, that seems like a horrible thing, but is it? Now, as He Jun mentioned yesterday, there's quite a bit of studies on this topic. So we talked about independence, interdependence, and presumably as a result of this, self-expression is very important. That's a cultural task in this Western cultural context. In Eastern cultural context, particularly East Asian cultural context, self-expression is not a big deal. That's not, certainly not prescribed cultural tasks. You are supposed to modulate your behaviors to be part of the community, blah, blah, blah. Those tasks are much more dominant, and in fact, He Jun has shown very nicely that European Americans share the value and the behavior of self-expression, but that doesn't surely apply to East Asians. And Jeannie Tsai, in a very related line of work, emphasized the significance of arousal dimension in emotion. So corresponding to He Jun's work, Jeannie Tsai argues that with the evidence that high impact, high arousal emotions are much more valued in Western cultural context, particularly among Stanford undergraduates. But that's not true. Much low arousal, calm emotions are valued among East Asians. Now, as you might expect, Asians say in the questionnaire that they suppress emotions more, and also more interesting research by Mouse and Butler shows by using autonomic reaction patterns that European American subjects appears to be threatened when they try to suppress their anger, but Asians appears to be challenged when they're asked to suppress anger. Well, you know, there's a pretty clear pattern of autonomic reactions where they are challenged as opposed to threatened. Now, on the basis of this, we ask this question: what will happen when you are exposed to pictures like this? You know, some are neutral, that's fine. When you are shown some awful pictures like those, what would happen, especially when you are asked to suppress your emotional expression? Two possibilities. In the current Western literature, the argument has been made with the evidence that people are capable of suppressing facial expression. Fine, but that has a consequence, because they never, European Americans never under-regulate internal processes of emotion. That's human nature. And presumably, because there's a conflict between your filthy emotion and your over-emotional behavior, your autonomic arousal systems rarely get excited, and this has negative health consequences and so on. Now, there's another possibility, however. Well, if you want to hide your emotion, why don't you underregulate your internal experience? I think this is this. Well, initial starting point of this research project is that this distinction might have nothing to do with human nature, you know, but this could be cultural in the sense that how important it is to keep internal experience of emotion. Is it sacred in defining yourself, or can it be malleably controlled according to social goals like suppressing emotions? So we use EEG signals to investigate to what extent individuals might underregulate their cortical processes when they are asked to hide the emotion on the face. Okay. And one particular element we looked into is called late positive potential. And this is very interesting potential that is happening in the parietal part of the brain and presumably catching up visual processing system activity. But however, it is connected to subcortical emotional regions like amygdala very closely, so that what happens is that when you find some emotional stimulus right in front of you, your attention is drawn to it and you begin to categorize it, you elaborate on the emotional information contained in the picture, so that there's a core tight connection between emotional reaction and cognitive processing. Okay? So the question we asked is that what could happen when people have to suppress emotional expressions? What could happen in this particular element? Cortical responses also underregulated, or a cortical response kept intact, even when they try to suppress emotions? So procedure was pretty straightforward. Subjects are shown one of those pictures at a time for a few seconds. And in one condition, they are asked to simply attend to the picture. In the other condition, they are supposed to hide the emotion on the face so that the person who's observing them in the other room cannot tell which kind of pictures the subjects are looking at. And here's the results. This is an Asian waveform. Well, Asian subjects are Asian-born Asians at the University of Michigan. And European-American subjects, a corresponding group of European-American subjects. And here, this is a control neutral picture condition. Here, emotional picture, negative picture condition. There's a very nice late positive potential. And as far as this result is concerned, there is no cultural difference. Well, it appears the European-Americans are a little bit less reactive, but there's no significant difference. Now, in the emotional suppression condition, Asians initially showed just as equally strong emotional reaction initially, but this quickly disappeared as if they underregulated this cortical response very, very effectively. However, European Americans didn't show anything. And if you look at frontal part of the brain, that's very clear evidence that they are trying to do something, or they are maybe suffering from the conflict they're experiencing. And so it's not clear whether this represents ability or inability to regulate cortical response or unwillingness to do so. It seems to me that part of it is unwillingness. Culturally, it's not right. It's not right to suppress internal experience even when you have to hide the emotion on the face. Now, one more topic I'd like to refer to is related to what Steve talked about yesterday, self-enhancement. Again, this is a very interesting topic. The notion of self-interest is at the center of social and behavioral sciences. Now, self-interest as construed as personal goal pursuit. You know, is that culturally universal, or is that dependent on, you know, people growing up in some particular cultural context? And, well, in the area of social psychology, this particular motto, self-enhancement or pursuit of self-interest, can be found in numerous ways, particularly self-serving bias is very, very strong. So for example, when you succeed, you take the credit for the success, and when you fail, you blame somebody else, like your professor, your advisor. Okay, Now, Steve, myself, and lots of other people have worked on this entire set of phenomena for a long time to show that there's quite a bit of cultural difference. So for example, this is very simple distribution taken from Steve's work, distribution of mean score in Rosenberg's self-esteem score, self-esteem scale, and theoretical midpoint is 30. So clearly lots of people are having very high self-esteem. It's quite interesting. Now, human nature, no, if you look at East Asian population, mean tends to correspond to theoretical mean. Okay, yeah, more recently, we looked at significance of the self by using some of the more indirect tests by asking subjects to draw a sociogram, that is, a graphic representation of their social network. Use a circle to represent yourself and other people included in your network, and why don't you draw this network by connecting those circles, right? Now, typical sociogram you find in American sample looks like this. Well, this is not an exaggeration, this is the real data, by the way. And typical graph you would find in Japan looks like this. And simply one very interesting replicable finding concerns the size of the cell. Now, we believe that this symbolic size really represents something when you have to draw a map of LA, you expand more real estate to depict real important things like your house or UCLA. And very much like this, Western population use much bigger self to bigger circle to represent themselves, but this doesn't happen. All right, now very quickly, we wanted to see if this is merely self-presentation. Immodesty is a horrible thing in China or Japan, and this is the kind of response that you can control relatively easily. So again, we wanted to use neural measures to address this question. Okay. So here, we use very simple cognitive tasks, flanker tasks. You have to perform very well to earn point. But in one condition, subjects are told that they can earn point to get wonderful things, wonderful gift for themselves. In the other condition, we told them, you have to work really hard to earn point so that you can get wonderful gift to your friend you nominate for who's living on campus so that you can send the gift to those people. And we compared those two conditions by running very simple flanker test experiment so that they have to tell the center letter is HOS. And subjects often make an error. Whenever they make an error, they show error-related negativity, big bump in negative direction. And this error-related negativity, ERP signal, depends on significance of the task. Much more is at stake. This goes up. So, well, we tested this. And this is ERN. And this is happening from frontal part of the brain. And there's no real difference or any effects at the behavioral self-report level. Now, ERN. This is European-American waveform in the friend condition. Pretty clear ERN. Now, self condition, there's a big bump. So clearly, they care about their performance when they are earning points for themselves, even though they claim that they work just as hard for their friends. Now, Asians didn't show this. Now, why is that? Well, theoretically, this must have something to do with interdependence. If you have interdependent self-construal, you are friend. It's part of you. Very much like if you are a good mother, good father, your kid is part of you, right? And if that's the case, this effect might be mediated by interdependence, and in fact, that was the case. Yeah. Well, this maybe seems like a very straightforward story, except it's a very interesting fact that this kind of correlation happens again and again and again with brain measures, but you know, unfortunately or fortunately, I never got anything like this when I was using reaction time, social judgment. So there's something very special and peculiar about the brain measures. Anyway, so let me summarize by briefly discussing what all this might mean in the context of my discussion early on about the nature of cultural influence. We believe the central concept is neuroplasticity. Brain can change plastically, even though, you know, basic structure remains very, very much the same. Now, this happens as a result of repeated engagement in cultural tasks. And then, really here, social science research is very important to figure out what kind of cultural tasks are available. Maybe ecology is important, maybe philosophy is important, maybe, you know, politics is important. Now, as a neuroscientist or psychologist, really, another interesting question is what would happen once the brain gets changed plastically. One thing that happens is that your spontaneous behavior change. You know, your brain is programmed so as to respond in culturally appropriate way, you end up showing that behavior. And that's a good thing. That provides very good evidence that you are a good person. You have an audience. You have an audience who would regard you as a decent person once you do this. Okay? And you cannot do it, you get into trouble. Very much like strange Japanese wandering into American street or vice versa. Now, what will happen is that your identity is established and the reputation could be enhanced, and this obviously has some consequences. Your success or your failure in work may follow, or very much correspondingly, your success or failure in biological reproduction market may also fall, and that's where evolutionary genetic consideration may well come in. So I obviously I have no time to get into this, but I like to share this with you to make very simple point that conference like this is very, very much needed, because to understand neuropsychology of human being, we really need to understand social, sociological, political analysis of the cultural context, as well as psychology of identity making, interpersonal processes of reputation. And brain plasticity has a real power when it's placed in this broad context. And from that point of view, I really find this conference so fascinating. So thank you very much.